Hello, welcome to Lazada Insider, featuring knowledge to make a difference. We share trusted insights, forward-looking perspectives, and exclusive expert interviews to keep you ahead of the curve.
Good afternoon, everyone. This is Janet Neo from Lazada Corporate Sustainability. Here we are today at Lazada Insider. Knowledge that makes a difference. And today we have back again our sustainability series, and we are going to catch up on part two of a very interesting chat with Anvaya from Ipsos Singapore. And our topic from the last episode was about intentions to actions. How do we narrow the say-to gap in sustainability, and that we notice about consumers' intent not translating into climate actions? So today, I would love to welcome back Anvaya.
Thanks, Janet. Happy to be back.
Yes, lovely. So now today, we're going to focus a lot more on the actions. And I would love to deep dive more in with you how the maps recap from the last episode about maps, from motivation, ability, processing, and also the notes on physical and social. How can we apply this? So I'd love to chat more with you. And here we go into our first question. Now we do have a block building block, right? Step by step to know how we can translate this intent and how do we find the matching gap to change it into actions. And in this regard, do you have some examples that you can share with us that you have seen that businesses have been able to leverage your map concept to apply to consumer actions?
Yeah, so I think there is a fair bit that we see that businesses have managed to leverage as well. Then there are, of course, you know, if we apply the maps framework, there could be multiple things that could be done as well. So if we talk about motivations, one of the things that people talk about is that, you know, sometimes I don't feel like doing anything about recycling because it is so difficult for me. You know, it's an added chore. It's an added task. Mm-hmm. So their motivation is really not there. But we see examples of a shampoo brand that wants people to recycle the bottle. So then the bottle can really be used anywhere. So what they have done is that they have a very simple perforation on the bottle itself. So that once you just break, you just look at the perforation, that entire branding, the plastic branding comes out. And then that bottle is debranded. It can be used as any other bottle, right? And there are enough signals and markers that each time you're using the shampoo, there are enough reminders that are there to remind the consumer that, okay, this is what you can do with the bottle, right? And you can then it's not an added chore. It's not taking time out of your daily routine that's there. And then once you do it, the consumer doesn't need to go that extra step of making sure they're recycling, putting it to the plastic bin and all that, which again, we know consumers are very compliant with that. So that is one in terms of motivation. In terms of ability, where we want to give consumers know-how to do it, I think brands perhaps need to do a little more when it comes to sustainability. Because right now, with a lot of things around, they may not know, okay, what exactly is sustainability? What is the magnitude of the sustainability that's there, right? So simple mental mapping, reference point evaluations can really help. So another point from health, again, to draw from is like the Healthy Choice logo from Singapore. That simply is a very good visual mnemonic that indicates that once it's there, you know that this is going to be like a healthy kind of a beverage brand. Yeah. So these, so that is how you make people sort of understand that, okay, what is it that it could have? In terms of processing, now, even if you know that, okay, this particular thing is sustainable, okay, eco-friendly, you need to also, brands need to be able to guide people to make the required impact. So what we've seen, let's say that people think that consuming local meat instead of imported plants would help them reduce their carbon footprint versus shifting to a plant-based diet. Now, why do they say that? Because they don't know what is the impact that each of these actions have, right? So if you do guide them onto what a certain thing could have an impact on. Now, it could be about percentages, it could be about certain, you know, milestones and make it tangible, then you're helping them process their actions about sustainability, again, in a very right direction so that it has larger impact. Physical context, again, we have seen brands, maybe not in Southeast Asia, but like in Japan, recycling is a big culture. And when we have done, you know, talk to seniors and with the aging population, they are very concerned about recycling. That is their habit. They want to be able to do that. But they were struggling with a lot of, you know, packaging, which they had to break and then, you know, make it into a flat box and then carry it. And we've seen brands which have made it into lighter kind of packaging so that it's easy, even with a lot of, you know, dexterity, a lot of motion control issues, to be able to collapse them and make the person feel that you're still, you know, recycling and playing your part in society. In terms of social signaling as well, we have brands, we have a beverage brand in Thailand, which markets itself to be only sourced by local ingredients because it wants to focus very clearly on the local farming community. So any consumer that is buying that brand is signaling to the world that I care about these values, and my values are that I care about the community, and I am, and that is my contribution to how I'm playing a part in my country and in my society. So there are very good examples of brands who may not have known about our MAPS framework, so to speak, but have, but we see parts of it being implemented. And when I'm talking about implementing it in a behavioral framework context, it is not that everything needs to be done at one go. It could mean that at some level you are influencing the motivation, but you also need to influence the physical context so that both work hand in hand in that context. Or maybe there is only one thing that is driving or that is a big barrier to this behavior change. And if you look at social signaling, you look at the social values that are there, those are the things that can help you solve and make sure that the consumers are playing their part into sustainability.
Right. That's very interesting how you have illustrated, right, the different factors in MAP and some of these examples. One of the things that I hear is that it's actually quite intrinsic to product design and the user experience. Like you mentioned about the shampoo bottle and how they implement the marking. So this is very like having, it's almost like having the product designer to be a lot more thoughtful and a lot more detailed about how a consumer would feel as they're using the product and how through that journey they could interject with the environment aspect where they can help not just raising awareness, but bring out that motivation that they want to do something while they are doing the washing the shampoo in every step, right? So it's going into more details, more thoughtfulness, more care to bring out things that can help consumers to be more motivated. And you shared a few examples, and I start to see that, you know, when a product could be in introducing a better product design that's helped with the eco awareness and the eco motivation or consciousness, bring out the consciousness as they use it, right? And then linking it to whether in the action, which is maybe recycling as an action, the packaging, how easy it becomes for consumers to recycle. And then it links to the purchasing part where you talk about values, social values, and when we talk about values today, it is almost signaling that consumers have gone beyond just looking at a brand promise, like a product brand promise. They want something bigger. They want a bigger reason why they want to support a particular product and what it stands for, right? And that goes into a bigger purpose bit, which some of the biggest FMCG brands we have noticed globally, they are very strongly tapped into brand purpose. And we know that brands who are marketing themselves, re-engineering the way they build brand promise, brand purpose, and igniting the consumers' love for like environment or for social issues, it has already now been proven that these products do better in the long term. So I also noticed our time here is really great that you have shared so many examples with us. And just for us to, before wrapping up, I would love to just ask you one more question on this study, right, and from Southeast Asia, that if business were to take actions today, and if they say that, like, hey, Anvaya, you know, I'm not an international brand, you know, I'm a startup. I just started a brand because I am behind ethical branding. I'm behind eco, and I want to produce a product that is fit for the earth today. And what can I do? Like, I don't have that kind of budget like an international brand. What kind of advice would you give them?
So my advice to them would be very simple, because I think, yes, you're right to say global brands have not only, you know, tapped into brand purpose, they've also started making commitments, which is like, we will do X percentage reduction of plastics by X date, etc. and all that. Yeah. Now, one of the things that we should, and customers are saying that, right? And I think plastics is something which is quite something that I think customers have started to expect. Because if I, as a consumer, am saying no to a plastic bag and a wet market or a supermarket, then I expect that the brand around me replaces their plastic straws with a paper straw, right? Why should it be any different? And we now see a lot of brands have done that. So now one of the things that a new brand, which is jumping into this bandwagon, needs to take care of is that certain things have become expectations from consumer. And at the end of the day, would they be able to drive differentiation, right? So if you now introduce a paper straw, it's not a big deal. That is what you should be doing. So what do you look for? And here is where you need to keep a pulse on where is your consumer sitting on a spectrum of sustainability? Because in reality, we like to think about it as one big block, but people are on a spectrum of sustainability. Some people are still happy with you know, reduction in plastic or saying no to plastic, whereas some of them have really gone to, okay, are they using renewable ingredients? What is the carbon footprint of my brand that I'm purchasing? And they're looking at brand values from that sense. We also have a new customer segment emerging, which is the Gen Z. And we know that Gen Z is driven by whether a brand fits in with my personal values or not. And sustainability is one of their personal values, right? So to these brands, I would say that first find out where is your consumer segment in your market. And there could be different market realities. And where are they on the spectrum of things? What is their level of understanding about sustainability? So are you going to be a guider brand? Are you going to be an enabler brand? What is the role that they would expect you to play? Like, do I guide you into, okay, here is the information, or do I make it easy and simple for you? So I become like an enabler of your actions. Yeah. And the realities of people around different markets with regards to the same issues around sustainability could also be different. Like, we have deliveries which are there, which highlight sometimes slots, which is less CO2 emission, right? Now, right. There could be people sitting in markets and saying, hey, there is no pollution in my country and it's okay, you know, for me not to inconvenience myself for that. But there could be people sitting in countries where people are really suffering in terms of respiratory issues. And that simple thing that is like, okay, here you can choose a time slot which has a lesser carbon footprint. That could be mean a lot of relevance to them and they could catch on to this. You should also look at what can help consumers have sustained changes, right, from a long-term perspective. Because for any brand to make huge investments into changing a lot of production, packaging, ingredients, it means a lot. And if tomorrow you feel, oh, maybe this is like a fad and we don't know how long this continues, then you need to make sure that you are again enabling them from that perspective, that you know they're going to be with you, they're going to be with the brand, and they don't leave you sort of midway. And brands should not always look at rewarding consumers, just keep nudging them, because nudges a lot of times mean that they're easy to do and they're short-term kind of gains, right? So I've gone to a convenience store and said no to a plastic bag and I've got a voucher for a free coffee. Now, does that mean that I'm going to every time say no to a plastic bag? That really may not happen. But then the retailer cannot keep on giving me free coffees that are there, right? So then you need to understand what exactly is the barrier, which is intrinsic. What is the environment like? And what is the right thing for us to look at in terms of interventions and solve it in that manner?
Mm-hmm. That's really interesting, Anvaya. Because from here, we also hear like, even like starting brands, they could also leapfrog even the biggest brands because some of the biggest brands have to re-engineer what they couldn't do before or they didn't think about before. But if they actually newer brands, they might have a head start because if they were at the beginning stage of thinking about consumers, what they need, the experience, how they feel and the pain points, they actually could leapfrog in terms of designing a product that fits. Yeah, and being relevant to what they need at this point in this era and the certain lifestyle or culture that they lived in, right? And I hear that really coming out really strongly for you is that culture, lifestyle, environment is not separate from the product. The best brands and the best products is integrated with the environment and the society. Yeah. Oh, that's really interesting. So any last words you would like to share with our audience before our closing today?
I would just say that, you know, you talked about, Janet, the entire customer experience. I think that is really what is there. So brands, we say, and need to be authentic. But just remember that when you talk about sustainability, you know, customers want to safeguard against any kind of greenwashing. So it needs to be really end to end in terms of your promise. So if you have, let's say, a non-plastic bottle that we have ordered and with renewable ingredients, but it comes in a lot of plastic packaging that's there. I think that's something that they're going to be calling out for. So consumers are quite conscious of it and they want brands to do and help them and guide them in this. And therefore, if any brand is authentic and looks at it not from a singular point of view, but looks at it from a holistic customer experience and the values that it is providing, I think it's really going to make its mark in signaling to the consumer that, hey, I'm there in that journey towards a better world, better environment, and more sustainable kind of actions.
Yeah, very, 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 very good. I love it, you know, the part about being authentic, because being in this field and sustainability, I oftentimes, you know, notice a very big difference between how marketers go about promoting products, like the brand product marketing versus sustainability communications. They are totally different.
Yeah.
In sustainability, it's like almost there's no need to shout out how good it is. But if your consumers, they will notice if there is a consistency in what the brand or the product says and what they deliver, and if it's consistent in the experience as well, and then the impact, then it's actually larger than what traditional product marketing promotions can achieve far more than that. So it's almost like a different mindset that marketers have to look within, like sustainable brand, branding, product marketing. It's almost a different kind of animal, right, that for them. Yeah, so this is really great insights that you have shared with us. And again, you know, we're so glad that we have you here with us at Lazada Insider. Knowledge that makes a difference. We definitely know a lot more that we didn't know before about consumers' behavior and intentions. And I would like to conclude today, and we would love to hear from all the audience, you know, give us feedback about your thoughts around consumer intentions and the stay to gap. Also write into us, tell us what kind of topics you would like to discuss about and what you'd like to hear about in the next coming up episodes on sustainability at Lazada Insider. And with this, I wish you a good day. Thank you, everybody. And thank you, Anvaya.
Thank you, Janet. Thank you for having me at Lazada Insider. And thank you, everyone. This was a very interesting afternoon and very interesting discussion.
This is Lazada Insider. We hope you enjoyed this episode. Make sure you click follow and subscribe so you don't miss our latest insights and expert interviews. Thanks again for joining us. Until next time, take care. Lazada.